Welcome to the Lord of Games podcast, also known as the Logcast. I am your host, Jephren Perez, and I am joined this week, as always, by co-host Dave.
How you doing, guys?
And Clay.
Greetings to everyone.
Greetings, greetings, everybody. How are you guys doing?
Pretty good. Always happy for the weekend. Very rainy day today. So... Which I actually don't mind that. It reminds me of the Northwest.
Nice.
I'm sure that's what you get all the time.
Pretty much every day. We've kind of forgotten what the sun is up here.
That's all right. You guys get a lot of trees, so it makes up for it.
Yes. And Clay, how you doing, buddy?
Good, man. I've got my coffee here, so I'm waking up. Got up this morning a little bit early, played some Mario, and I'm ready to do this.
Nice.
Yeah.
Good deal. So, what have you guys been playing? We'll start with Dave.
I've continued to play almost exclusively Zelda. Though I haven't played it as much this week because I've been trying to get through Iron Fist on Netflix as well, which is not a game, but
nice.
Yeah.
That's still interesting.
Yep. So my time with Zelda has been a little bit less this week, and it's probably because, you know, now I'm just doing cleanup because I've beat Ganon, so now I just want to get the shrines and stuff. So
nice.
Pretty much just been doing side quests and looking for shrines and trying to get as much done as I can.
How many shrines do you have?
I think I need to look at the screen because I just got a bunch. I'm guessing around 50.
Okay.
Maybe 50 plus.
Getting there,
so.
Almost halfway there.
Yeah, I'm getting there. I just did all the Lost Wood Shrine Trial, Korok Trial stuff, so did all
three. Those are a bit of a pain.
Only the one, really.
I struggled with one of the other ones, too.
Ah.
But it was the first one I did, and I did it pretty early on. I did it well before I even got the Master Sword. So.
Well, the Run the Gauntlet one was like super easy. You just had, if you had a lot of stamina, you could just run through most of it.
And then use
your jump ability to get over like a lot of the... places where you were like had like a lot of like the quicksand or not quicksand, the like the sort of sink mud
the
that
tar,
you just died
yeah.
in tar or whatever. Yeah, you could just like jump over most of that.
I had to climb trees and use my sailcloth.
Me too.
And I kept getting out of bounds. I think that was my biggest issue.
Oh yeah, that does happen from time to time.
Indeed. Okay.
But,
anything else?
Other than that, I played a little bit of GTA 5. Online and did I don't
nice.
Know I didn't know what I was doing.
That's okay. Just stick with it.
Yeah, and there was so much like loading times and the game got froze on me twice while loading.
Yeah, it does.
And I'm like, oh my gosh, this is. I get everyone likes this game and I get it's fun when it gets going, but there's a lot of technical issues going on.
Yeah, it struggles a little bit to pick up, but once you're loaded into a good session, like you're golden.
Definitely.
Okay. And Clay, what have you been playing?
All right. Well, I've been playing quite a bit this week. I did put Zelda back in this week. I don't think I've touched it at all last week. After I beat, you know, Ganon, I went back today a couple days ago, and spoilers, I went and bought a house. I don't know if that's a spoiler, but so I've been decking that out and just kind of screwing around with that. And there's some other areas around that I've heard of that are pretty cool that I want to go check out. So
nice.
But I didn't spend a whole lot of time with it this week, but I did get back into it a little bit, and it's still fun. I still really like it. We played Rocket League yesterday.
Yeah, new update.
Yeah, we played that. I'll let you talk about that when it's your turn.
Okay.
I've also been playing Grand Theft Auto 5 with you guys, and we had a really good session last night. Actually, we played for quite a while, but
yeah,
we made some big monies, so that was cool. And then I've also been playing Mario Maker. That was actually what I was playing this morning before we started recording. And we've been sending each other levels back and forth. And you've been a good sport, Jeff, playing my super ridiculously difficult levels. But
yeah,
it's been fun. I love that game. I when it first came out, I played the crap out of it. But I had like one friend, because I didn't know you guys at the time, that had the game, and he just wasn't, he couldn't handle, you know, my levels. And so I just mostly played, you know, random people's levels that I found, and that was, it was enjoyable. But playing each other's levels and building levels for each other, I think, makes it even better. So
absolutely.
It's been fun getting back into that. It was the first time I powered my Wii U on since I got my Switch, and that controller feels so weird, the tablet thing.
Right. Feels so Fisher pricey.
Yeah, it does. But it's still comfortable, and it still works, and is great. So that's been fun. And then the last thing I played last night, I got to play Splatoon 2 on the Switch. They had their second global test fire, which ran from 11 to midnight my time last night. So there was one this morning at like 7 o'clock. I decided to skip that one. I didn't get up early for that. But there's also one this afternoon at 3, and then another one tonight at 11. So I'll at least play the one this afternoon. But it's good. I mean, I love the original, and so Splatoon 2 is a lot of what you already get from the first one. Obviously, it's like a limited kind of, you know, live test fire thing. So there's only so much you can do. There's only four weapons that you can choose from, but they do introduce, you know, a couple new elements, and there's some new stuff in there. I think there's two levels you can play. And so I played for the full hour last night and had a great time. There's some new things. They moved the jump button around, and the map feature without the, you know, the touch screen is taking a little bit of getting used to, but it's still super awesome. It looks great. So I'm super excited for it to come out, I think this summer. So I'll definitely be picking that up.
Cool.
All right. That's the end of everything I've played. So what about you, Jeff?
Well, pretty similar to yours, minus Splatoon. Played some Rocket League, which we did, I guess, yesterday, with the latest update came out this week, which is, I can't even remember what it's called, but it's
basically
like a better take at basketball, at hoops, or volleyball. I don't know. It's a big open arena, and you slam the ball into the floor to make the floor disappear, and then once it's disappeared, you can score through the hole in the floor, which sounds really weird in practice, and it took us a little bit to even figure out what to do, because we played a couple of private matches just to figure it out. But once we had the hang of it, I think we really had a good time.
Definitely.
It's a good update. I like it a lot better than the weapons. I know that, I think you guys like the weapons a little bit more than I do, but
yeah,
which there's, that was a fun addition, and I don't hate them, but it takes some of the skill out of the game. It makes it a little bit up to chance, which I don't like as much, but yeah, it's a good update. Also played Mario Maker. I kind of just picked it up middle of the week and made a level. I don't know. I've been watching this YouTuber called, it's like Ryukar or something. He just plays the hardest Mario Maker levels and makes them look like cake. And he's got a good show. I watch it at work sometimes, just in the background to keep me occupied.
Totally. I used to do that.
Yeah. So it got me back into it. I made a level and I shared it with you guys, and then it kind of got us going with that, which was pretty cool. Stayed up late last night making a level that was pretty trolly. There was some difficult platforming, but there was also some trial and error in it, to share with you guys. And it sounds like you beat it this morning, but struggled a little bit with it.
I didn't struggle too much with the first half, a little bit, but it was that after the checkpoint, there's just a really short segment before you hit the end of the level, and man, you were killing me. It was, in fact, I figured it out, and I could literally see the finish line or whatever, and I was in the air, and I hit that swamp guy or whatever that you meticulously put there, and I died, you know, 3 feet from the end, and luckily I didn't like freak out and throw my controller across the room. It was just more of like I was smiling like, are you freaking kidding me?
Yeah.
And so and then it took me like 10 more attempts before I got back there, but yeah, no, it was fun. It was a good level, dude. So
thanks. Yeah, no, I was inspired by the one that you did.
I have another one in the works. Oh, good. So
I played one of Clay's levels the other day. It took me an hour and 20 minutes to beat it, and I got to the very end, and I overshot the goal. It was in Super Mario World. tile set, and I overshot the goal and ended up hitting a thwomp, and I was so pissed.
I don't even remember putting that there, but that's not cool, man.
But so I decided to troll back, and it was a good one. It was, it actually probably took me longer to beat it myself last night, and I actually added the checkpoint after failing at beating my own level for like half an hour. And I was like,
I couldn't imagine doing that, dude.
Yeah, because I beat it entirely as I was making the level, but only section at a time. I was like, okay, yeah, that was hard, but I can beat that. But doing them all in succession and not failing was really hard. So
it would just take forever, probably.
Yeah.
You'd probably get it eventually, but it might take you days to do it.
Yeah.
But I get that.
Anyway, congrats on beating that, because it was hella trolly. And then GTA 5, as Clay mentioned, we played the prison break heist last night. We did the final setup mission and then the finale. And I don't know. It was a good time. We struggled a little bit, but yeah, we made it through. And then, yeah, I think we might try some more of those this week.
Definitely.
And also just been kind of doing the side quests on Zelda. I think I'm up to 33 or 34% the way through it. So
nice.
It's still so fun. So anyway, I think that's enough about what we've been playing. It's been a good week for games, but we can move on into the news. All right. So to kick off the news, we have our now traditional weekly segment up until at least the release of the game with the ukulele character of the day. And by tradition, we'll have Dave kind of walk us through that.
Yay, I'm a tradition. All right, so we got another 5 ukulele champions here to go through. A lot of these we've seen before, but let's go through them anyway. First off, at the bat, we have a Nimbo the Cloud.
That's the one I was thinking of with the other one, the one that can't pee.
Pardon?
Yes, yeah, you were confusing them last time. Yeah. I realized that.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah, this one's, we've pretty much seen this guy a lot in, like, footage, because I think he's, I'm pretty sure he's in the first level, so we've seen quite a bit of him. He's just a, you know, friendly-looking cloud with a face. Pretty normal in the world of ukulele. After that, we have the famous Rextro 64us, who is, I guess, supposed to be kind of like a throwback to low-poly N64 characters. And he's pretty cool-looking. And he's sort of, I believe he's kind of like the keeper of the sort of arcade games that are hidden in each level.
Mm-hmm.
Which I imagine, I'm not sure, have they actually said that you basically unlock the multiplayer games by beating him in single-player? But I don't know.
Yeah, I'm not
I feel
sure.
Like that might be a thing. So that's kind of his purpose. And he's got like a little medallion around his neck, which I feel is probably going to be like a game token or something. Like, I wouldn't be surprised if you have to like find the game token in the level, take it to him, and do something like that to get the game.
I think they've said that that's the case, yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yep.
Well, I was right. And next up is our next in line of medieval piggies. And this is Sir Scoffs-a-Lot. And he's he's got some candy canes. He's like a little chubby piggy. I'm not sure how the candy canes play into anything.
Yeah,
seems kind of.
Well, he also has donuts
bit.
On his belt, so I think he's all about the food.
Interesting.
Seems to be his thing.
Okay, it's just scoff
like a British
means something different
thing
than
for junk food.
In the UK.
I don't know.
Because it looks like he's someone who's like eating a lot of food.
I thought,
and I think of scoff, I think of it to scoff at someone.
Like the expression, yeah.
Yeah.
It's just being scornful is what I'm seeing. To scorn someone, I guess.
So.
Oh. Okay.
I don't know.
Don't get the pun, but okay.
I'm sure there's one there. We're just too American to get it.
Well, we'll check this out on their Twitter. It says, there's a quote for each character, and it says, spirited efforts, warriors. I do hope Leap-A-Lot hasn't scoffed all the steak and lobster, so... There's your answer. I think scoff.
Okay,
is,
so it also means
there's
to
shoving
eat.
Your face.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Learn
the
something
you know.
New every day.
There you go.
There you go. All right. Next up is the probably one of the most recognizable and talked about characters of ukulele, and that is Trouser the Snake.
That's a pun I get.
Yep.
What could that possibly mean?
I don't know.
The only thing I'm disappointed with is he doesn't have a patched eye.
I was going to say he has two eyes instead of one.
I know, he should have a patched eye. Or maybe that would be just two on the nose, maybe I don't know.
Yeah, the ESRB wouldn't allow that.
He is in charge of move upgrades, and he is wearing some suspicious-looking shorts.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I guess I never really thought of that. They are kind of banjo-esque.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Maybe he got them from somewhere.
Yeah, stole them, tight
maybe,
item.
Maybe he rummaged through a particular bear's laundry and got them.
Gross.
I love his old like, early 90s, whatever, cell phone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, shoot, that might even be 1980s. That thing's huge.
Yeah, it might be. I don't remember how all that came out. Yeah. But
right.
When I was a kid, we had walkie-talkies that were AT&T branded and shaped exactly like that.
Really?
They even had like the dial pad. They were awesome.
Those would be so cool to have now.
God, yeah.
And everyone back then was like, the future, this is amazing. I'm not tethered to anything. Yes, it weighs more than like 10 bricks, but
yeah,
whatever.
Right, yeah.
But you could talk anywhere.
You could talk anywhere. And now we can't get away from them, for better or for worse. We are always reachable 24 hours a day. Next up is Corplet Drone, and as a fan of Rare Bees, I enjoy him greatly.
Yep. Yeah, his quotation here is, "Hello, I'm a Corplet Drone. I've no dialogue in ukulele, but please look forward to my inclusion."
That's great.
Yeah.
I'm hoping there's a similar like DKC-esque sound effect when you kill them. Like, I want the bzzz.
Yeah, I mean, like the Zubas and the...
Yeah, I want that so badly.
Things from Banjo too. Yeah.
It was so satisfying in the Donkey Kong Country and Banjo games to kill bees just because of that noise they made, and I loved it.
Mm-hmm.
So, whoever's in charge of doing wacky sound effects, probably Chris Sutherland, please make that happen.
Mm. Yeah, him or Kirkhope.
Him or Kirkhope. All get together and make some wacky bee sounds.
Seeing as the game has gone gold, I think we're a little late for that plea, but hopefully it's in there.
Hopefully.
Although, speaking of the game going gold, we've got a little bit of news of an update to the game code. Clay, you want to handle that one?
Yes. This is pretty big news this week that actually just dropped here over the last couple days. I'm trying to remember exactly who the first outlet was that announced this. Do you remember who it was Jeff?
It was gamesindustry.biz.
Right.
That's
Chris
right.
Dring, he's actually the co-host of Rare Replayed podcast, so it was a pretty reliable source.
Right. Basically, they announced that JonTron had been removed from ukulele. And so, obviously, I think we had heard, you know, last year at some point that Playtonic had reached out to JonTron based on the fact that he was a big Banjo-Kazooie fan and he was showing excitement in this, you know, this game and this revival and everything. And so they thought, you know, hey, it'd be great to have you be a part of this project. And so I don't remember how in depth they went with it, but basically we walked away pretty much knowing that he was going to be in the game. I think we heard that he was doing, you know, some voiceover work or something. And so, other than that, I don't know if we really had heard anything more about it up to this point. But basically, Playtonic was saying that they needed to, distance themselves from JonTron, due to, you know, if you've been following this situation, basically, JonTron, he, YouTube personality guy, very popular, had made some statements, on Twitter and elsewhere, and then he was invited onto a like a live stream debate thing of sorts that I think was on Twitch, and super long, you know, debate, but said some things that were questionable and arguably, you know, what have you. Some people would, you know, were accusing him of being racist and all this stuff. And so he had his rebuttal on his YouTube page, and it was a huge thing. It was all over the news. And so basically Platonic had said that, you know, we can't be associated with this. And so they had to remove him from the game, and I'm assuming are going to be patching in new, you know, audio for whatever character it was that JonTron was voicing. And so, yeah, this has been it's a big topic, in our, you know, area this week. You know, it doesn't matter what your opinion one way or another, who's right and who's wrong in this. It's going to affect the game in some form or fashion. And so, I will say that I have noticed there has been a lot of negative, you know, feedback being thrown at Platonic. But really, I know Dave, you mentioned this last night. I don't really know if there was a win for them in this. I think either way they handled it, it was going to be bad one way or another. They're going to upset somebody some way or another. So it's just, it's unfortunate that this happened, but
a thing I did wanted to add just real quick is how the whole thing kind of started before Reason Game Industry, reached out to Platonic in the first place is because the review copies got out and his name showed up in the credits and a lot of people didn't think he was still going to be in it. And so before all these negative comments that we're seeing on Facebook now, there was a ton of negative comments on NeoGAF, people making threads, people saying they were going to cancel their pre-orders, and people who were canceling their pre-orders because he was in the game. And that's kind of what prompted Game Industry to reach out to Platonic. They had the statement that he was gone. Not officially, mind. I mean, they did officially, but they didn't do through official channels, probably trying to be as low-key about it as possible, which didn't work out. And then everyone who is a follower of JonTron then started leaving negative comments on Facebook and Twitter posts.
Well, so I wouldn't say it was just JonTron's followers that were leaving negative comments, but...
Well, yeah, fair. I'd say a good deal of them were, but yeah, there's definitely people who just heard about it who might not have been super invested anyway, but didn't like the idea of it, who got in on it too. But yeah, so they had the timing was really bad for Platonic. I think that's kind of what I said last night, is that if all this had happened before the game had gone gold, they could have just quietly removed him, not made any comment, and probably avoided the whole controversy.
Yeah,
because they could have just said, anyone asked, like, oh yeah, that the whole thing on Twitter, that was just us playing around and it never worked and nothing ever came of it. You know, it wouldn't have been a big deal.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
And so, obviously, we're not going to sit here and, you know, debate, you know, who's right, who's wrong, blah, blah, blah. But we just wanted to kind of bring it up, and this will probably be something that will go down in our little history books of our little nerd fandom. So, it's worth pointing out. Jeff, did you have anything you wanted to add to this topic?
No, I think you guys pretty much covered it. I think, it's an interesting move, and it was not a win, or it was a lose-lose for Platonic,
definitely.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, I agree.
With that, we can probably move on to the next topic, which was the weekly Sea of Thieves video. This week, they just uploaded a new musical track, Tavern Tunes or whatever they call them. This is their third one from the game, or fourth one now. Fourth one from the game. And it is the front end track. It is what plays when you're on the menu in the game. Came along with a quote from Robin Beanland, and his quote is as follows. The thinking behind the mood of the front-end music was to incorporate a darker version of the main theme, but not too in-your-face, as it could wear thin pretty quickly. More mysterious and anticipatory. So you get a variation of the main melody played on the low woodwinds against a subtle but driving motif from the violin, viola, and nickel harpa? Yeah, nickel harpa. I've never heard of that. I really like the interplay between the violin and viola further into the piece, along with the sprinkling of low brass cordage and the odd bit of piccolo. This is version one of the front-end music. The plan is to have something granular that has a life of its own and is driven by the software. I'm still working out how to do that without it sounding random. So it's pretty cool. He's just a testament to Rare and putting in literally dynamic menu music, dynamic front end music, I think is really cool. Not unheard of. I think Killer Instinct for Xbox had some dynamic menu music where moving through the options in the original release would kind of play the chords of the music, and other ones, you know, you kind of change intensity as you get deeper into the menu and stuff like that. But I think it's pretty cool that they're doing that.
Yeah, definitely.
And anybody who's had a listen to this music, it's very good. It's very moody, as he said, and kind of gives you that uneasy, like, we're in dangerous waters feel. So definitely hit the nail on the head with this one, as Robin often does.
Yep, I love this track.
Yeah, it's great.
It's good background music if you ever just want to feel really epic. Just have it going in the background.
Yep.
I could see myself listening to that while cleaning the house. Mm-hmm. Just have that blaring over this.
I've already done that. I can say that it's pretty good.
I hope you talk in your pirate voice while doing that as well.
Yeah. And say things like, swabbing the kitchen. Yeah, exactly. All right. And there was one other video uploaded to Rare's YouTube channel. Who's going to cover that? Dave, Clay?
Yes, that was my... Yes. So I'm taking my point.
I was just moving us along.
I know. I'm giving you crap. Anyway, Jet Force Gemini Gone in 60 Seconds video was sort of posted.
Games in 60 seconds?
What did I say?
Gone in 60 seconds.
Games in 60 seconds. Yes, I'm sorry. I meant to say games in 60 seconds.
It's an okay movie, though.
Yeah, this was posted to the YouTube, though it is currently set to unlisted right now, so you can only find it through an article on Rare's website, which is kind of strange. But anyway, since it's so short, we thought we'd just kind of play it and give you a little listen. And yeah, if you want to take that away.
Right? Yes.
Hit the button.
Space is the place to shoot ants in the face. Yes, the drone army of that colossal cosmic sodomizer has swamped the system, leaving only twin space cadets Juno and Vela to clean up the mess. With some help from Jet Force mascot Lupus, who's a laser dog with rocket feet, and googly-eyed defector Floyd the droid. So off we all go, from the greenery of Goldwood to cerulean sapphire sands, and onwards to a reckoning at Mizar's big shiny palace. And to reach the final showdown, you just have to rescue all the tribals. Easy! You'll wield weapons as diverse as the world you drop in on. Favorites including the shuriken for surgical head removals and the tri-rocket launcher for just winning everything. You'll also feed fish and hit up a nightclub where enemy grunts strut their flunky stuff. So this is hardly hardcore dystopian science fiction, just a galactically good romp. The Rare Replay version even comes with brand new controls for modern tastes. So if you could just fire it up and gasp and swoon at how much we obviously already care, that would be lovely, thank you. And that's Jet Force Gemini, everyone. Cheers, bye.
All right.
Brilliant, brilliant voiceover work there.
James Thomas nails it with the 60 seconds series, which is what the article is on the website is about.
Yes.
And you can find that at rare.co.uk and click on the news section. And they've got literally just a recap of all of their games in 60 seconds that they've done so far. So pretty sweet. Check it out.
Mm-hmm. James Thomas, also the voice of Mini Pinata. Just wanted to throw that out there.
And he's a donut.
I know. Every time I see him now, I just think of the Viva Pinata noises.
Yeah. Yeah. So that pretty much wraps up our news for this week. It was quite a bit of it, but thanks for bearing with us, and we will now move on to our main topic of the week. All right, so this week we are discussing the GoldenEye team, essentially, and what became of them, the part that split from the Perfect Dark team and went off on their own to form their own company. Not dissimilar to the Banjo team, or half of the Banjo team, and Playtonic. Just to kind of kick it off, do a brief recap of the company. So Free Radical was formed in 1999 when looks like five-ish members of the GoldenEye team decided to split from Rare and go work on their own project and do their own thing. It was David Doak, Steve Ellis, Carl Hilton, Graham Norgate, and Lee Ray. I'm not too familiar with Carl Hilton or Lee Ray, but I do know, I think most people know David Doak from GoldenEye just because of his appearance in the game as Dr. Doak.
We've all shot him so many times.
Yeah. And then Graham Norgate is pretty well known as a Rare composer. So the others, I assume, are engineers and artists that are also less known, but equally as important. So kind of to jump into it, the game they started working on was yet a kind of a different alternate spiritual successor to GoldenEye, not dissimilar to Perfect Dark, and it was called Time Splitters. And I never played the first one because it was not available on the GameCube.
It
was like the best PS2 launch title.
What was that?
What?
It was like the best PS2 launch title.
Oh, it was a launch title?
I probably should Google that before I say it, but I'm fairly certain it is.
Okay. That would mean it would be out before Perfect Dark. Interesting.
It was...
No, it would have been after. It was like 6 months later. Just kidding.
October 23rd, 2000.
Yeah, that's a launch title.
Yep.
Wow, I did not know that.
I did not play. I did not own a PS2 at launch because I was a hardcore GameCube kid back then.
Same.
But it was one of the first games I did pick up when I finally ended up getting a PS2. And if you've played the other Time Splitters, before I go deep into this, am I skipping ahead?
Nope, you are right on pace.
Okay, I'm just making sure. I didn't want to be cutting you off from something. This is almost, I almost compare this a lot to Titanfall, in that there's kind of a sort of story weaving into the multiplayer deathmatch, but it really is all multiplayer deathmatch.
Okay, that's interesting.
It's the same kind of situation where it's like, a group of, really renowned FPS devs broke off from their parent company or former company and then did sort of a game in a similar style, but kind of, with not quite as feature rich as the one previously. And that's kind of what the first one was. It was a lot of fun, but if you're looking for a sort of comparable single player experience to Perfect Dark and GoldenEye, it wasn't there. It was just a really fun, little multiplayer FPS.
Interesting.
Wacky characters and
so was
really
it
fast feel.
I mean, so it's PS2, so by default PS2 is just two player. You can get the multi-tap, but so was it just local two player split screen? Because I don't even think PS2 went online till a little bit later.
No, it was offline.
Wow.
I can't remember if the multi-tap thing was usable or not, but I never don't think I ever played it with more than two players.
Seems kind of...
I think I mainly just played against bots and stuff when I did it.
Yeah, that seems a little underwhelming, but I understand, it's their first project and it's on a new system and they're trying to get it for launch, so... It's really similar to Titanfall, because they were trying to get that as a Xbox One launch game and ended up slipping into the spring.
I know, there's a lot of parallels there.
Never knew.
But yeah, it was definitely fun for what it was, and I think it offered a really fun couch and multiplayer game for people who got PS2 at launch. So,
cool,
good game. Yeah.
So their next game was Time Splitters 2, and I think this is the one that put them on the map, in my opinion, because it came out on all three platforms at the time: Xbox, GameCube, and PS2, and it had a full story that was not terribly dissimilar to Perfect Dark and just all the weird stuff. And it controlled exactly how you would have expected Perfect Dark to have controlled had it come out on GameCube. Which is...
Right.
Not to go on a super tangent here, but it just makes me more sad that Perfect Dark Zero controlled so differently than the original, because Time Splitters 2 had kind of nailed it. And maybe that's why, I don't know. But
what was awesome with Time Splitter 2's controls is that it was completely mappable.
Yeah, that was also
nice. Anything you wanted. It was like If you wanted to use your face buttons as the C buttons and pretend it's an N64 game, you could totally do that.
Mm-hmm. Which didn't work too well on a GameCube. Probably worked better on a PS2.
Oh.
Right.
Yeah.
Because the probably. Weird layout of the B, the X, and the Y.
Yeah, I never played any of the Time Splitter games on GameCube.
Yeah.
Primarily yeah, for me, because of the controller.
For me, my first introduction into the series was Time Splitters 2. In fact, I remember exactly when we bought it. I think me and my brothers were in a store. We were with my mom as she was shopping at Sam's Club. I don't know, Dave, you're probably familiar with Sam's Club. Jeff, have you ever been to one of those?
Used to have a membership.
Not really. Okay. Not really the place you go to buy video games, but they had this there for GameCube. And I remember me and my brothers looking at it and we're like, I've never heard of this thing. But right on the front of the GameCube cover art, and there's a little like quote in the corner that says, "Heir apparent to GoldenEye."
Yeah.
And that was like all we needed. We're like, whoa, this has to be good if it's like yeah. right up there with GoldenEye. We didn't even know that, you know, some of the same dudes, you know, created it and stuff. So, So we ended up getting it, and man, freaking loved it, and it's still one of my favorite GameCube games.
Yeah.
I know it's not really a GameCube game, but like as far as being solely on that console, but and I still love playing it. In fact, just talking about it right now makes me want to play it. But yeah, it's so good. I wish we could like play multiplayer online somehow. But yeah, we used to play the crap out of this. I thought the single player campaign was great. The multiplayer was amazing, obviously. I loved that you could play with bots, which was we used a lot of the time. I loved all the different multiplayer options that they had in it. Like, mm-hmm. I don't know if you guys remember Virus. That was like one of our favorites.
Yeah.
So much fun. And then I loved all the challenges they had, where there was like a zombie challenge where like stay alive as long as you can. You only have this mm-hmm. gun. You can't leave the room. All that stuff like just really added to the replay value of it. I never had this one on PS2, but I know after we bought this one, we ended up finding the original on PS2 and we went and bought it. But going backwards, it never was as good, but we enjoyed it enough to have it. And then I think we did eventually get the third one, but, most of our time was spent playing the second one. And how many freaking characters you get in multiplayer was just out of mm-hmm. this world.
Totally.
Right.
I know I'm all over the place here, but I get excited, but yeah,
no,
you could be like
a
you could be a freaking monkey in multiplayer. Like how cool is that, dude? Like, it's so sweet.
Yeah.
Go back real quick to the marketing for that game, because I was so confused by it when it first started. Because when I first heard about the game, I can't remember if it was in a mall or a store, but there was a video of it playing, and then it was showing like footage of the Siberia level, which looks, you know, very GoldenEye-esque, and then it's like from the creators of GoldenEye.
Yeah.
And then it's not a rare game, not and rare. I remember being so confused by that when I first saw it.
Yeah.
I was like, what? How is this possible? This isn't a rare game.
Luckily, I followed it very closely on IGN because, mm-hmm. I think even the reason that I got as into Rare as I did, more so than that I was already a fan, was that IGN was huge Rare fans. I mean, they covered them extensively, and they were really excited about Time Splitters 2 coming to the GameCube. And so I was already well aware that you could pretty much just ignore the first one because of there wasn't much of a plot to it mm-hmm. and that this was sort of, you know, this was the spiritual successor to Perfect Dark and GoldenEye that we wanted. So I was pretty aware of who made it and what it was, and I picked it up as soon as it came out and I loved it. I can't remember, was Time Splitters 2, did it have the level creator, or was that in Future Perfect?
I feel like it was Future Perfect.
Yeah, I don't think it was in 2.
Okay.
See, with believe it or not, Time Splitters 2, I actually didn't play until way later.
Really?
I played the first one I played, I went from the first one to Future Perfect and played 2 last.
Interesting.
Yeah, I didn't pick it up for GameCube because I didn't want to play that on a GameCube controller, and I really wanted, at that point, I really wanted an Xbox because of Rare.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, oh, this is perfect. I can get Ghoulies, Conquer, and Time Splitters 2. And then I never ended up getting an Xbox.
Dang. Yeah, I wish I would have. That would have been sweet.
Yeah. Because, like, I wanted... I was very much a purist, and I did not... I wanted to have something similar to the C button setup, and I was like, I can't do that in GameCube controller. I don't, no way I'll play the game.
Oh, you version. Wanted to play it in the original control format.
Yeah, that's I funny. Actually played it at a store display on Xbox, and I set it to, I set up the controls so I could strafe with the face buttons, and I was like, this is the only way to play. Any way else is wrong.
What's interesting is when I set it up, I set the C stick to instead of act like a modern C stick where it literally is just moving your head freely. I set it to match GoldenEye or, you know, whatever the GoldenEye controls were within Time Splitters, where basically C right is strafe and C up and C down, just look up and look down, inverted. And I played through the whole game like that because that's what I knew and that's what I was used to. And I'd never played a twin stick shooter because I had a GameCube.
Right. I do legitimately miss playing FPSs or GoldenEye and Perfect Dark with their original control configuration.
I don't.
It's so unique.
I liked it.
I might hate it now if I actually did it, but
I've gone back and played GoldenEye and Perfect Dark both on the N64, and it's a little bit of a struggle, especially with the inverted camera. It's doable, but I can't go back to that. Not anymore.
Yeah, it's just like I just don't know how I would do the time trial stuff in like the Xbox version of Perfect Dark. It's like, it was all about the speed strafing, and it's so hard to do in twin stick mode.
Well, I don't know. I don't think so, because your left stick strafes. I mean, and then you.
Well, yeah, but it's less precise. Control. And to get some of those, you had to be so perfect with getting the most speed out of everything.
How is.
I find it really hard.
I don't want to start a whole debate, but I'm just curious how it's less precise as far as strafing. Like, literally, left on the stick is strafe left, and left right on the stick strafe right.
Maybe I just suck at control sticks, and Clay can probably attest to this, as my ducking abilities in the Tropical Freeze with an analog stick.
Yes. Yeah. Don't get me started on that, man.
I watched that. That was painful.
Yeah. I find it a lot hard to hit the wrong direction when I'm using an analog stick as opposed to a D-pad.
That's interesting.
True.
I'm not very good at it, apparently.
Okay. Well, sorry. Fair enough. So Time Splitters 2, I think, was a pretty good success for Free Radical. I don't know the sales, but I'm pretty sure it did decent. So rather than make the next sequel, which we've kind of alluded to as Future Perfect, they actually made a game called Second Sight. And this one I actually know nothing about. So
I know it was published by Codemasters instead of EA. So it was kind of that was kind of an interesting thing.
I'm well, no, remember Time Splitters 2, I think, was Eidos or whatever. EA
oh,
only picked
right.
up the third
okay,
one.
Okay, so they changed. Yeah, so they were just switching publishers left and right back then.
Well, I think that was because Eidos, I don't know how they're pronounced, but I think they had gone belly up at that point or been bought out or something.
No, that makes sense.
Maybe, so, maybe not. I'm not 100% set on that.
Well, I mean, I know they're like pretty much owned by Square now.
Mm-hmm.
Or Square Enix, right. But I don't know the entire saga of what happened to that publisher.
Yeah, so Second Sight was Codemasters. So, I mean, it was good that they were a true third party and not tied to a publisher. It must have been nice.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe that was complicated. I don't know. Maybe that's not as easy as it sounds because you kind of have to beg for the funding and support every time. It's kind of like a new struggle every time rather than, like, Nintendo will just pay for your next game.
Yeah. I don't know much about Second Sight either, but I did do some research on it when I was, you know, getting ready to talk about all this, and never had heard of it, never seen any footage for it. But yeah, basically it's an action adventure stealth game. It was on GameCube, PS2, Xbox, and Windows. It's kind of like a psychological thriller type game where this guy is basically trying to recover his memory. And from the footage I watched, it basically looks, a lot of the character models and stuff look identical to the Time Splitter models. So I assume they use a lot of previous assets or what have you, to make this game. And so, while it didn't really look like something I would enjoy, I don't really do the whole psychological thing. It doesn't really make for a good time for me. It still looked good. And it kind of looks like a weird, like, side project of Time Splitters, so I wonder if they just did that, you know, to be able to quickly knock out another game and kind of get away from the Time Splitters you know, thing. But the review scores and the reception of it all seems somewhat positive, mostly 7.5 out of 10. It seems like the PC version wasn't as received as well as the console versions, but I wouldn't say it was a huge flop by any means. It seems like it did all right.
I'll have to check that out. Right. Yeah.
I've heard really good things about it. I think I've played it on like Dolphin via emulator for like 5 or 10 minutes.
Okay.
Come out on the GameCube?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Really?
Came out all three. Just like,
sorry. Sure, you just said that.
Everything from Time Splitters to Future Perfect came out on all three consoles.
I wonder why I didn't get it, because I pretty much just got every GameCube game that came out at the time.
Well, there you go. Go pick it up. Yep, play it.
I shall.
You still have original hardware to do that on, unlike me.
Yeah, I have both a GameCube and a Wii original that will both play them. So,
yeah.
Cool. Well, it's interesting. So then from there, they moved back into Time Splitters, or I don't know if they had two teams just working simultaneously or what. You know, I don't know how the setup was. I'd imagine just one team. But they went back to Time Splitters and did Future Perfect, which, I don't know, I got it at launch again, and I think it's a better game than Time Splitters 2. It's a more complete package, but I don't think I enjoyed it as much. I don't know if it was just the story or what, but I know I like Time Splitters 2 better.
That I really played to death was Future Perfect.
Okay.
I will agree. I think it's kind of a similar situation with GoldenEye and Perfect Dark. It's kind of interesting that way that it's called Future Perfect.
I know.
It's kind of like the Perfect Dark.
Really
like,
messed with my head.
The single player, I don't think, is enjoyable. Nearly as enjoyable as Time Splitters 2. But I found the multiplayer to have more things.
Yeah.
I had so much fun with all the challenges. And
I did like the multiplayer more. Things.
Yeah, I thought the multiplayer and Future Perfect was just insane amount of things to do.
Yeah.
Similar to, you know, Perfect Dark on the N64.
Right.
So I think that's literally their... I think it's a harder line between these two, between GoldenEye and Perfect Dark, because I feel like with that I can clearly say that Perfect Dark is better.
Mm-hmm.
But there's so much I like better about Time Splitters 2, mainly the single player, I think is vastly superior to Future Perfect's single player.
I believe this
is the time that... from what I heard is that EA really interfered with the development of this game, particularly in the single player with the marketing and the characters and stuff.
That sucks.
And that shows through a lot more, whereas Time Splitters 2 was like when they could do whatever they want without much oversight.
Interesting. Yeah, so what I mentioned earlier, like I played around with the level creator in this a lot and I loved it. It was so cool. Do you guys ever mess around with it?
I didn't, and now I'm like kicking myself for not doing it because it sounds awesome. I don't know why I haven't, because that would be super fun. But
I wonder if I still have any of my levels saved. Not that we could play it online, but if we ever do a site staff meetup, we can play some.
Yeah,
that'd
be fun. It'd be awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, could be fun.
And the GameCube supported native 4-player.
That's true, and Future Perfect was, I think, the first Time Splitters game that supported online play for PS2 and Xbox, so that is worth noting.
Oh, okay. Nice. Yeah, it's good to know.
Yeah.
It doesn't say anything about it in the notes, but did you guys hear about Time Splitters Rewind?
I did. I've read about it.
Sounds familiar. Yeah, I feel like I've heard of it.
Yeah, it's basically kind of a fan... I believe it is sanctioned, though, by, like, Crytek, the IP holder. And it's sort of like a fan attempt to recreate the multiplayer of the 3 Time Splitters games.
That's cool.
Yeah. Yeah, so it might actually be possible for us to play this stuff online at someday.
Yeah. I guess there was a huge thing that everybody signed. What's the word I'm looking for?
Petition.
Petition, thank you. Yeah, there was just like, I don't remember how many it was, like 75,000 or something people that signed this petition and sent it to them. And I think it was after that that they finally they were like on board with it. So, but cool. I haven't heard anything about it in a while, but that's usually how those kinds of things are. But
last update was from last month, February 11th.
Oh, wow. So that's pretty recent.
Okay, yeah, they're still going for it.
Yeah, they just put up a model of the nurse. And they have some gun models from last year and things like that. So
nice.
They're working away on it. I imagine it's one of those things where most of the people are doing it in their free time, so it probably takes a while.
Right.
But I'm sure it'll happen eventually, just like GoldenEye Source did.
I was going to say, in like Half-Life Source, and there's several fan projects that are similar. Cool. Anything else on Future Perfect or you guys?
Nope.
Good. Okay. So their last game is Free Radical and their first game on the whatever PS3. Generation. Yeah, I was going to say the next gen of the time was called Haze, and it's another one that I didn't get. I didn't get a PS3 till way later in the cycle, and I just never picked it up. Have you guys played Haze?
No.
I have played through the demo, and it was so bad that I didn't buy the game.
That sucks.
It's not regarded as a very good game,
I mean,
from what I saw.
I might be exaggerating it a little bit and remembering poorly. I mean, it probably really it was one of those games that really isn't as bad as people remember. It just had such high expectations coming after Future Perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And it felt so much like a just another futuristic FPS.
Right. In 2008.
It was like, everything that I loved about Free Radical FPSs is not in this.
Okay.
So why am I playing it? Why don't I just play Halo or something else?
Right.
Well,
and I know there was tons and tons of studio drama and issues going on at the time, and they were struggling to get that game out.
Hmm.
Well, it's interesting you bring up Halo because I was watching some video reviews on the game, and one person was talking about how Haze was being kind of marketed, or at least the word on the street was that this was going to be the Halo killer.
Hmm.
And
right.
how this was going to, make... Halo, be old news and everything. And I guess from what I saw, the original footage, as sometimes these things go, looked really impressive, real potential, looked really good. And then, compared that to what the final product was two completely different things.
Yeah.
And I guess
voice acting was really
and so the guy that was doing the review actually said he had thought about buying the game but never pulled the trigger until one day he found it on Amazon, and he ended up getting it for a total of 1 cent plus shipping.
Wow.
And so that was when he finally picked it up and reviewed it, was when he could buy it for 1 cent on Amazon. So take that for what it is, I guess. I don't.
Right.
Yeah.
I remember there was a ton of marketing for it too. I don't know if you remember this, but the new metal band Korn recorded a song called Haze to promote the game, and they did a video and everything with footage from the game in it. And I was like,
wow.
How much money are you guys spending?
Well, Ubisoft
to promote this
Ubisoft
game
published it. Yeah. So. That's crazy.
It's just like such a weird oddity now for anyone who goes through that band's back catalog and find this song for this obscure game.
Right.
Remembers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Huh. Okay. Well, so Haze was a little bit of a blemish, but they were still known well enough that they were purchased by Crytek, which is a pretty major FPS developer at the time.
Well, do we want to talk a little bit about what happened like right after that with them going into administration and laying off quite a lot of their people?
Did that happen before the purchase? Is that why they got bought?
Yep,
up?
That's
okay. Go through that.
So what happened
is
they
that.
Actually locked the doors, and a lot of people showed up to work and couldn't get into the building.
Jeez.
And they went into this sort of administration mode where they basically laid everyone off that wasn't a key person and tried to get someone to buy them, and that's sort of when Crytek came in. The worst person in the world to get bought by, we find out years later.
Yeah, go figure. Crytek seemed like on top of the world at the time. I mean, they were making this, the Cry engine was just the most advanced next gen visual engine there was. And they had, what was their first game? It wasn't Crysis, was it? Or was it Crysis? All their games start with Cry, and it just gets really confusing.
I think the first Far Cry might have been.
Far Cry, yep, that was what it was.
Yeah.
Really confusing. Far Cry was well reviewed and just graphically amazing, and so they were a good match because this stigma of people coming from Rare where they were known for good graphics and good gameplay and all this, and it seemed like a marriage made in heaven at that point.
Yep. I think I don't remember how many years passed between. I know that we sort of just kind of didn't hear anything from them for the longest time after they got rebranded.
Yeah.
And then they eventually, it came out, I'm not sure if it was really super publicized, but it was eventually mentioned in an interview somewhere that, hey, that the Crytek UK guys, aka Free Radical, they're tackling the multiplayer mode to, Crysis 2.
Mm-hmm.
which was kind of also kind of a big deal because the first Crysis had never came to consoles, and there's always this joke about Crysis being like, this is how you benchmark a PC
in
Crysis.
Yeah.
So that was kind of a big deal at the time. Crysis 2 is coming to consoles, multiplayer, special console-based multiplayer done by, you know, the ex-Free Radical guys. And I remember being actually hyped enough to, like, you know, go pick that game up the first day it came out.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Was it any good? It was... Never played it.
I enjoyed it. I don't think it was... It has the same problem I think a lot of FPSs have through that era of feeling a little too samey to other games.
Mm-hmm, totally.
There was nothing overtly wrong with it. The multiplayer was fun enough. There was nothing overtly wrong with it. But I had the same problem. It felt too samey and too many other games dead parts of the things that it was doing better.
Yeah.
Whereas the first Crysis kind of felt like really unique. It felt like they just kind of went with the sequel. Just kind of, hey, let's do the Call of Duty thing, but do things a little bit different.
Mm-hmm.
Integrate stuff from this FPS game. And it's just, I don't know. I'm not really knocking it. I don't think it's a bad game. I think it's worth picking up if you have something to play it for. But, you know, it just, once again, I got the feeling that this is not what I want out of the Free Radical team, you know?
Yeah.
So it was all right. I've had fun with it, beat it, and played the multiplayer a little bit, and then didn't really touch it again.
Cool. Yeah, so after that, they pretty much went on to do the multiplayer for Crysis 3 2 years later. And I guess then they did the Xbox 360 port of a game called Warface, which is another one I've never heard of. Just 2014, not that long ago.
I have not played either of those two.
Yeah. Okay.
Warface is a free-to-play online first-person shooter developed by My.com and co-produced by Crytek UK.
Nice. Okay.
360, and then they had a 360 port, obviously.
Yeah.
The 360 port was discontinued on February 1st, 2015.
God.
Had mixed reviews. Doesn't look like it did very great. Kind of mid-range, 50 out of 100 kind of thing. So.
Well, that's unfortunate. So at this point, I don't know the full story here either, but I would assume it was a similar situation. I know people weren't getting paid. Because Crytek was having monetary issues, and eventually the studio was closed again. It sounds like very similar to what happened the first time. Yeah. Dave, do you have any more insight into that, or is it pretty much similar?
Yeah, I know they weren't being paid, and people were basically starting to leave. The producer, they were working on Homefront, a sequel to Homefront Revolution. Basically the director and producer just straight up left because he wasn't getting paid. More and more people were leaving. I know there's some legal reasons why it can be a bad idea to leave if you're not getting paid, because then you can't claim some of your lost wages or something like that,
right?
Maybe in Germany. Mm-hmm. But there was a reason that a lot of them were just feeling kind of forced to stay. It was like this really negative work environment where it's like, we're not getting money, but it could be worse for us if we leave,
mm-hmm,
type thing. I don't know if I don't think they were ever officially shut down. They were just stopped paying. Then once Crytek started to liquidate certain assets, they sold the whole roster of the studio, the building, and the IP for Homefront to Deep Silver.
Yeah.
And so it's slightly different because I don't think anyone ever stopped working this time like it was when they went
to
the
administration. Oh, I see. Okay. Mm-hmm.
But yeah. And then they got a lot of the people that who had left, who hadn't found jobs yet, they got the director to come back and continue his work on the game.
Oh, man.
And then sort of reformed them as Dambuster Studios.
Yep.
To try to finish the game they were working on.
Which eventually they did, came out last year, and it was a train wreck. It did not review well.
Right. I finally picked it up, and I wouldn't call what I've played so far a train wreck.
Right, I've heard it's been patched.
Slightly bland so far.
Yeah.
And what I'm playing is very different than what the review people had.
Exactly.
Because I know there's a lot of technical issues that eventually got resolved. I am looking forward to playing. I picked up the version. It was on sale, so I picked up the version of the season pass. And I know that the third DLC, they're actually going to try to fix the main complaint remaining, which is the bland environments. They're going to have like a whole new area that doesn't look like someone just barfed on it. So, I'm curious to see, basically try out some of that stuff. I need to play it more too to give a full impression, because I do get the feeling that probably the stuff that they create post all that Crytek drama will probably be a bit better. You know, when people are getting money and stuff, it always usually makes people work harder. Strange how that works. But yeah, I don't think I have much more to say about it, because I still haven't played through it enough to say more.
Yeah, so that's their most recent game in a pretty troubled history. There were two games that yes.
Time Splitter, Siberia level is hidden in Homefront: The Revolution.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Worth mentioning, definitely.
Definitely worth mentioning.
Pretty cool. It's kind of cool to go in and find that arcade. I haven't done it yet. I need to figure out where.
I thought that'd be the first thing you'd do.
I know. I think I have to play farther to get to that point, though.
Gotcha.
But yeah, you can literally play a Time Splitters level, and theoretically, it's the only way to play a Time Splitters level on a modern console is through Homefront: The Revolution. So. Okay. I don't know, I just find that very interesting, though, that was allowed to be in, because it's my understanding of the situation, unless something's changed, is that when Deep Silver bought the company, they just bought the company and the Homefront IP, and the Time Splitters IP is still with Crytek.
Yeah, I thought so too, so maybe...
So, maybe there was just like a little bit, some money exchanged hands, or Crytek was like, we've screwed you guys enough, we're not going to be dicks about it.
Yeah, it might just be like, look, this is already in here, it's... Not right. Something that's an active IP right now. It's not going to hurt you guys any.
So
I don't know.
I guess my hope for the future with it, the fact that they clearly still have a reference for those games, the fact that they put them in. And I'm hoping now, finally, after all this drama is over, like what they're going to do next after Homefront, I am kind of curious. Because now they finally, hopefully, have a good parent company that's going to pay them and maybe not just throw them... intellectual property scraps to work on like they kind of did with Homefront.
Yeah.
And I'd like to see them do an original IP and make something maybe a little bit more reminiscent of their old games.
Totally. Yeah, it would be great to see them kind of get back to their roots and do something in their kind of a nod to their heritage. That'd be pretty sweet. Worth noting, there was a couple canceled games along the line, actually just two listed, but one of them being Star Wars Battlefront 3, which was a pretty major one back in the mid-2000s when they were still Free Radical.
Oh, yeah.
Forgot to put that into the list because it was a canceled one, but it was an interesting one because I think it was completed, so awesome. And then it just wasn't released. Yeah, it was almost,
And what's really sad is it looks so much better than the current Battlefront game that eventually got released in this place.
Yeah. It's arguable, but I agree that
that was such a perfect fit for Free Radical.
Definitely like, was, yeah.
Yeah, and I was so excited about that, and then it just never came out.
Yep, it was unfortunate. And then I guess they were in the talks of Time Splitters 4 with as Crytek back as recent as 2012, but just never happened. And that's when they kind of switched over to the Rewind thing. So,
right.
That's kind of the story of the team that left Rare from the GoldenEye team. For better or for worse, they've had a heck of a journey, but we've gotten some great games out of it, and they think they're not done yet. You guys have any final thoughts on this?
I think they should bring Time Splitters back, but
definitely.
I don't even know if that's realistic. I think a lot of people probably think that. So,
right.
I think that'd be awesome. And if not, I would love a new shooter from them that isn't some weird, like, futuristic, like, shooter kind of thing where they're mm-hmm. trying to do the whole Halo killer thing.
Yeah.
Something maybe original and just that really fits them, I think, would be awesome. So I hope that they finally find a studio that they can feel comfortable in and not be constantly worried about, you know, they're not getting paid and losing their jobs
right.
and stuff. I would just love to see a happy ending to this story where they're jumping, you know, from studio to studio all the time.
Yep.
Right. Yeah.
Definitely agree.
I think it'd be hilarious if they did do a spiritual successor to Time Splitters. to be like a spiritual successor to a spiritual successor.
Right, I think that'd be awesome.
Yeah, I'm on board. Yeah.
Yep.
So, I imagine the Time Splitters IP, I don't know if that much is going to be done with it because it's Crytek's in charge. If they ever do something with it, they'll probably give it to another dev. Mm-hmm. The most I could ever see is maybe they'll do a remastered trilogy collection done by an external company or something.
That would be cool. I mean,
if there's enough, if there ever becomes enough interest in it, which I don't know if there is outside of people like us.
It'd be funny if they hired 4J Studios to do it just because of their work on Perfect Dark.
Right. Here, port the Time Splitters like games, please.
Yeah.
No, it's such a shame, too, because they, I don't even think the Time Splitters game ever came to 360 backwards compatibility, did they?
I'm not sure. I didn't.
Yeah, and they never got released on PS2 Classics, on PS3, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
It's just like, they've been so lost to that generation of consoles, and they're such great games. They need to be freed. Someone needs to do something.
Indeed. That's our call out. All right.
Anyone who's listening that can make that happen, find a way to do it.
And with that, I think we've covered it. So, as always, we ask that you all follow us, subscribe, like. We are on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, and iTunes and Google Play. We ask that you please, if you enjoy the show, give us a review, a like, however you can give us something. It helps so much just to get exposure and lets us keep kind of doing this week after week, or at least justify it to ourselves. with that, we thank you again, and we will talk to you next week, which should be a very interesting show, so you don't want to miss it. So,
yep.
Bye, everybody.
You guys have a great day/weekend.
Bye-bye.